Shalom Israel, this is Bishop Nathaniel. The Israelites have been scattered across the four corners of the earth, as prophesied in Deuteronomy, the 20th chapter. Here at Israel United in Christ, we need your help to recover the remnant of our people, teach them the gospel. Please help us, support us, and join or donate to the Booster Club today. Shalom.
Shalom, family, most high in Christ, blessed. Welcome to another edition of 15 Minutes with the Captain. I'm Captain Zabit. To my left, I have
Officer Mariah.
So today, we're going to get into the Inquisition of Agrippa. We're going to talk about Paul's conversation that he had with King Agrippa. Let's start with the book of Acts, chapter 26 and verse 27.
The book of Acts, chapter 26 and verse 27. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. And Paul said, I would to God that not only thou, but also all that hear me this day were both almost and altogether such as I am.
So, see, Christians will use that scripture and say, hey, Paul was converting the other nations to follow us. And what we believe and teach here as Israel United in Christ is that the scriptures are for the 12 tribes of Israel. And we're going to prove that's still the case, regardless of what Paul is saying right here. And regardless of your misunderstanding of Christianity, Paul is not teaching anything different than that the 12 tribes of Israel will be saved. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 19 and verse 18.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 19 and verse 18.
Uh-huh.
And the judges shall make diligent inquisition. And behold, if the witness be a false witness and have testified falsely against his brother, then shall ye do unto him as he had thought to have done unto his brother.
So what was required was that the judges were supposed to do a diligent inquisition. That's what was supposed to happen. And when Paul was on his original trial dealing with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, what he found was that they didn't do a diligent inquisition. They was making opinions and making decisions based off of their feelings, right? Can I get the definition of inquisition?
Inquisition, an investigation conducted with little regard for individual rights.
So it means an investigation supposed to take place. Go ahead.
A severe questioning. A judicial or official inquiry or examination, usually before a jury.
Is that it on that?
The act of inquiring.
The act of inquiring. Let's get the synonyms for inquisition.
Synonyms. Disquisition. Mm-hmm. Examine. Examination. Mm. Inquest. Inquiry. Investigation.
So an investigation. That's what's supposed to be happening during an inquisition. Go ahead.
Research. Study. Mm-hmm. Probation. Probe. Probing.
Mm-hmm. So what you're supposed to do in an inquisition is probe into what the person is being accused of in order to make a solid recommendation to the court above you. That's what's going on in this case. When Paul is sitting here talking to Agrippa, an inquisition is being made. Let's go and prove that. Let's go to Acts chapter 25, and let's start at verse 24.
Acts chapter 25 and verse 24.
Yeah.
And Festus said, King Agrippa, and all men which are here present with us, ye see this man, about whom all the multitude of the Jews have dealt with me, both at Jerusalem and also here, crying that he ought not to live any longer.
So what the Jews were saying, what the Pharisees and Sadducees were saying, is that this brother shouldn't live any longer. But he couldn't understand why they were saying that. If they would have done a proper inquisition, then they would have been able to make a realistic determination. But what they was doing was basing it off of their opinion, off of their feelings. So we'll see what Festus and Agrippa are doing. Go ahead.
But when I found that he had committed nothing worthy of death.
So when Festus did his own research, when he did his own investigation, he found that he did nothing worthy of death. Go ahead.
And that he himself had appealed to Augustus. Mm-hmm. I have determined to send him.
Now Festus said, I got to send him to Augustus. Go ahead.
Of whom I have no certain thing to write unto
but
my
he
Lord.
But he had to write out what and why he didn't think he was worthy of death. Go ahead.
Wherefore I have brought him forth before you, and especially before thee, O King Agrippa.
So you would bring in someone to verify the evidence. That's what King Agrippa is doing. He's an expert that can verify certain evidence in the case. Go ahead.
That after examination had, I might have somewhat to write.
So he said, after you examine him, Agrippa, I should have something to write. Go ahead.
For it seemeth to me unreasonable to send a prisoner, and not withal to signify the crimes laid against him.
So he couldn't identify the crimes. He didn't see anything wrong with what Paul was teaching. So he said, hey, I need to bring in an expert so I can write out what is going on. So Paul, understanding that, he's going to have certain things to say to Agrippa as we move forward in this case. Let's look at verse Acts chapter 26, and let's jump over to verse 5. Go ahead.
The book of Acts, chapter 26 and verse 5, which knew me from the beginning.
So Paul is talking to Agrippa right here. He said, from the beginning, this is what I've been doing. Go ahead.
If they would testify that after the most straightest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee.
So Paul said, I lived a Pharisee. All right, let's see what that means, to live a Pharisee. Let's go to the book of Acts. Where are we going? Acts chapter
23, verse 5.
Acts 23 and 5. Let's go.
Acts chapter 23 and verse 5. Then said Paul, I wist not, brethren, that he was the high priest.
So he's talking to the council before, right? He's talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees before he deals with Felix and Festus. Go ahead.
For it is written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people.
Mm-hmm.
But when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. Of the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am called in question.
He said that the reason why I'm here on trial is because of the hope and resurrection. Go ahead.
And when he had so said, there arose a dissension between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the multitude was divided. For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit.
Okay.
But the Pharisees confess both.
The Pharisees confess what? In the resurrection. Well, who was resurrected? Christ. So what is Paul saying when he's saying, I am a Pharisee and I was brought up as a Pharisee? He said, I believe in the resurrection. And I'm saying that Christ was resurrected. Let's jump back. Come on, jump back to Acts chapter 26.
Verse 6.
Verse 5. Read verse 5 again.
Acts chapter 26 and verse 5.
Uh-huh.
Which knew me from the beginning, if they would testify, that after the most straightest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee.
He lived the Pharisees, meaning he believed in the resurrection of the dead. Go ahead.
And now I stand and am judged for the hope of the promise made of God unto our fathers, unto which promise our 12 tribes.
A promise what?
Our 12 tribes.
So the promise was to our 12 tribes. That's what the promise was to. The promise of the resurrection. Go ahead.
Instantly serving God day and night, hope to come.
Uh-huh.
For which hope's sake, King Agrippa, I am accused of the Jews.
He said, this hope of the resurrection, this is what I'm accused of. But you understanding what the Pharisees believe and teach, guess what? You're going to be able to see that the case that I'm laying out is nothing in opposition to what the Pharisees already believe and teach. They just don't like the fact that I'm including Christ in this resurrection. Let's jump over to Acts chapter 26 and verse 27 again.
The book of Acts, chapter 26 and verse 27.
Yep.
King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest.
So he's saying, look, I know you got to write out something for me. I know you got to write out the Inquisition. You got to write down the facts and what you have determined, the things that I'm being accused of to the Roman court. I know you got to turn this information in. So I know you've been an expert. Read that again.
King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest.
Uh-huh.
Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian.
You almost persuaded me to believe that Christ was resurrected. Go ahead.
And Paul said, I would to God that not only thou, but also all that hear me this day were both almost and altogether such as I am, except these bonds.
So he said, I wish that y'all all believed that Christ was resurrected. Why? Because you'll be able to write a solid report on what I believe. You'll be able to present positive reinforcement on what I'm believing. Go ahead.
Keep and on. When he had thus spoken, the king rose up, and the governor, and Bernice, and they that sat with him. And when they were gone aside,
When they went down to figure out what to write, go ahead.
They talked between themselves, saying, this man does nothing worthy of death.
This man does nothing worthy of death. So the case that Paul laid out to them, they was able to back him up. And the Inquisition that was put in place, they were able to say, hey, this guy is right. it's no reason for him to be put to death for something that we already know that the Pharisees believe and teach. Right. There's no reason to be put to death for that. Go ahead.
Then said Agrippa unto Festus, this man might have been set at liberty if he had not appealed unto Caesar.
So if this case would have stopped right here with me, with him just laying out the evidence with me and you, Festus, he wouldn't even have to go to Caesar. But since he chose to appeal to Caesar, now the case got to go all the way up. But we're going to write him a positive recommendation. That's all that's being said here. Let's jump over to Romans chapter 9 and verse 4.
The book of Romans chapter 9 and verse 4.
Yeah.
Who are Israelites?
Yep.
To whom pertaineth the adoption?
What did Paul write? Now, Paul wrote the book of Romans, right? Paul wrote. Go to Romans 9 and 1 and 1.
The book of Romans, chapter 1 and verse 1.
Yep.
Paul.
Who?
Paul.
So Paul wrote this. Go ahead.
A servant of Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
Called to be an apostle. Separated unto the gospel of God.
So go to Romans 9 and 4 again.
Romans chapter 9 and verse 4.
Yep.
Who are Israelites?
Who are what?
Who are Israelites?
So Paul didn't lose the thought that the Israelites are going to be saved. Paul didn't lose that thought because he was going through an inquisition, going through a court case. He didn't lose that thought. But he knew that since he was dealing with that specific inquisition, it was a way he had to deal with the people. Mm-hmm. Read that again.
Who are Israelites?
Yep.
To whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises.
Yep.
Whose are the fathers, and of whom as concerning the flesh, Christ came.
So according to Paul, Christ came for the Israelites. And how does that now contradict what's being said in Acts? It doesn't. He's not contradicting himself. He's saying, I need you to believe what I'm telling you so you can write the proper information for the evidence that has to be presented to the higher court. That's all he's saying. Read that again.
Whose are the fathers, and of whom as concerning the flesh Christ came,
uh-huh,
who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen.
So it's no different. So Paul didn't lose his mind during the time of Acts and start teaching the other nations that they could be saved. Right. No, he was going through a court case. It was certain information that had to be presented so he can get a proper representation at that next court case. So with that, Israel, I say shalom, Most High Christ bless.
Shalom, Most High Christ bless.
We used to scream black power while Haram was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission, minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold. From Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone. 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are how men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.